All right, now we want to initialize and start building our network. I would like to follow the hyperparameters cheat sheet one by one and tell you how I decided to set which of the values that I'm changing in the network. The first one we have is batch size. I'm not going to change it that much in this example. I'm just going to keep it as 32. That's the default value, but I noted it here in case you want to change it afterwards. The next one we have is the number of neurons in the input layer and the number of neurons in the output layer. But as we talked about, this is going to depend on the data set. And as I mentioned, in this data set, we have a 32 by 32 image that has three channels, red, green, and blue. That's why this is the dimension of the input layer that we are creating. And we have 10 possible classes. So that's why we're creating 10 neurons for the output layer. Next, we have a number of neurons in the hidden layers and number of hidden layers. So basically, if you remember, in the previous example, we only had two or three layers. And in each of these layers, we had 300, 200, and 100 neurons. As I mentioned before, when your problem gets a little bit more complicated, which is the case right now, because we were working with a 28 by 28 image that was only black and white, now we're changing to a 32 by 32 image that is colorful. And the problem is a little bit more complicated also if you think it's just digits written, handwritten digits. But here we have a bit more complicated features like a dog, a ship, or a horse, a car. So these things are a little bit more tricky to classify. So that's why we need a bigger network, basically. So we're going to go on with five layers and then see what happens if our network is able to fit the pattern of the data or not. But basically, I think five is a good starting point. And, you know, we can always lower it if we feel like that's too big of a network. Having too many layers would actually not hurt us. Instead, having too few layers would hurt us and would really limit the capacity of the network. The more hidden layers you have, the more complicated patterns you're going to be able to fit, but at the same time, it's going to take a longer time for the network to train. So there is that trade-off, but having more layers is not going to hurt your performance. And actually, a Google researcher called Vincent van Hooke apparently called this the stretch pants approach. So instead of trying to find a pants that will fit you perfectly, you just get too big of a pants and maybe you'll grow into it later, or the pants are going to get smaller and then in time it will fit you better. So basically, it's not going to hurt to have too many layers. So we're going to start with five and see how that goes. In terms of the number of neurons in every layer, so it used to be kind of accepted to have sort of a pyramid or a triangle structure. So you start with a lot of networks in the first hidden layer and then lower it as you go. But that myth is kind of busted and people don't do it that way anymore. So it's actually okay to have the same number of neurons in each of the layers. And again, I'm kind of following the same stretch pants approach and have a lot of neurons in each of the layers and, you know, see how that's going to work for us. One thing apparently that might work in some cases is to have more neurons in the first hidden layer than the other ones. But, you know, we don't have to make it complicated. Let's just go with the same number of neurons in each of the layers for now. Now, next thing that we want to look at would be the number of iterations or epochs. So let's start with 30 for now, 30 epochs. And then, you know, depending on how our graphic looks of the validation loss and the training loss or their accuracies, we can decide to increase the epochs or not. And if you remember, I mentioned in the simple exercise, after you finish running your model once, if you do not initialize it all the way from here, if you just run the fit function again, it's going to train the already trained network 30 more epochs. So if you run this once and then you realize you want to run your network a little bit better, train it a little bit longer, then you can just run this line again. And then effectively you have trained your network for 60 epochs. All right. Activation function and weight initialization and optimization algorithm, I'll talk at the end. We have the loss function. as I said, loss function depends on our problem. Now we have a problem where things can be one out of those 10 things. So we're using sparse categorical cross entropy. The learning rate, I'm just going to keep it to the default right now, which is 0.01. And that's good enough for us. We don't have to change it much, but I'll also show you in this exercise how to schedule the learning rate. All right, the last things is the activation function. So for the activation function, we are going to use Selu. What Selu does is it is a variant of ReLU. It's like, I don't know, like a 10th generation variant of Selu. And Selu has the power to normalize your network automatically. So we do not have to have batch normalization in between to be able to deal with unstable gradients. So in that sense, it's a really good activation function. If you remember in the lesson notes we talked about, in the lesson summary notes from the unstable gradients lesson or the module, we see that there are some prerequisites to use Selu. So one of them is that we need to normalize the inputs before we feed it to the network, which we're doing right now. And that this network needs to be fully connected. That is the case. We are using a dense, fully connected network. We do not have any skip states, or we do not have any scarcity in our network. Another one is that we need to use the lacun normal initializer, weight initializer, and that's exactly what we're doing. That's also one of the hyperparameters we need to set. And basically, effectively, once we decide on the activation function, we are also deciding on the weight initialization technique, that is lacun. Let's see if I'm forgetting anything. Right, the last thing is the optimization algorithm. For this one, I'm just using the gradient descent one, but the default gradient descent in Keras is gradient descent with momentum. So basically, I'm using gradient descent with momentum for these optimization. And I have a validation data set aside, and that's it. So now let's run this network with the settings that it has right now, and then observe what happens with the performance.